Almost a third of Australian students are failing to meet new NAPLAN standards on literacy and numeracy after a radical shake-up of the testing system. Let's head to Nine Federal Politics reporter Eliza Edwards now, who's in Canberra. Good morning to you, Eliza. The results are now in and they don't look good.
No, they don't, Jane. A mixed bag in the latest NAPLAN results. Almost two-thirds of students assessed as exceeding and strong in reading, writing and maths, but another 23% fell into the category of developing, while 10% need more support. These are the first results since the testing system was overhauled, raising the bar of minimum standards that students have to meet. Experts say the reason for that is to easily identify who is falling behind. The concern is that Indigenous, regional and lower socioeconomic students are the ones not able to keep up. The Education Minister says now that those who need more help are being identified, it's time to do something about it. Jane.
All right, Eliza, thank you.
Well, how much do you, as a parent, worry about the education of your kids? The latest NAPLAN results have laid bare the education crisis in this country. More than 400,000 Aussie students are falling behind in a major way. And if something doesn't change, these children have little hope of improving. Our teaching methods and curriculums are clearly not working. The pressure on our teachers is immense. Our leaders need to step up and rescue these kids before it's too late. Education Minister Jason Clare joins us now. Jason, good morning to you. I mean, this is supposed to be the lucky country, and this is a massive educational fail.
I think this shows, Carl, we need serious reform in education. This report makes that blisteringly clear. It shows that 1 in 10 children are below the minimum standard that we set for NAPLAN this year. But not just that. It shows that 1 in 3 children from poor families, 1 in 3 children from the bush and 1 in 3 Indigenous children are below that minimum standard. And not just that. You know, what the evidence shows is that if you fall behind in third grade, it's very hard to catch up by the time you're in year 9. Only about 20% of children do that. And as a result, we're seeing some of those children drop out of high school, not finish year 12, and that's at a time where more and more jobs require you to finish high school and then go on to TAFE or uni. So this is serious and requires serious reform.
It sure is. I'm not sure what's more serious. And you've had, I mean, you're a can-do guy. You've had a bit of time now. 400,000 kids out there waiting for help. 400,000, that is just not good enough.
Yeah. Well, and to be fair, Carl, what we've done this year with NAPLAN is raise the bar. We've lifted the standards students are expected to meet, and we've done that deliberately so that we can better identify the students that need extra help. The next step is to provide them with that extra help, and that's what the next National School Reform Agreement must be about. I've got to negotiate that with the states and territories next year, as well as bilateral agreements with each state and territory. We've committed to making sure that we put every school on a path to full and fair funding. Mm. Not every school's in that situation at the moment. Non-government schools are above the level that David Gonski set. Public schools are below it and not on track to meet it. We've got to fix that funding gap, but we've got to fix this education gap that this report makes clear as well. So we've got to make sure next year that we tie this funding to the sort of things that are going to help children who fall behind to catch up and then to keep up and ultimately to finish high school.
I don't know. I mean, 15 years of NAPLAN, 10 years of needs-based learning, and it's a pretty deep fail. I mean, is it actually, should it be continuing?
Oh, you know, I think these tests are important because they help to identify the children who need extra help, extra support. You know, Carl, I talked about finishing high school. Over the last 6 years, we've seen a drop in the number of children finishing high school, particularly from poor families and from public schools. 6 years ago, it was 83% of children finishing year 12 in public schools. It's now dropped to 76%. And as I said, this is at a time where you need to finish high school. So, you know, the pressure's on me and other education ministers to make sure that we tie funding to the sort of things that are going to fix this.
Right.
And that's what the agreement we strike next year's got to be about.
I don't know what we're waiting for. I mean, parents are struggling with the cost of living and mortgages. They can't do everything. They put their faith in this system. You're outlining issues that need to be fixed and today. You're aware of them. What's to stop you doing it right now?
Oh, we are doing it right now. I've commissioned Dr. Lisa O'Brien, the former head of the Smith family, to tell me and other education ministers what we should tie this funding to next year. Now, one of the things that's mentioned in reports in the papers today is catch-up tutoring, where a child that falls behind at school gets taken out of the classroom of 20 or 30 kids into a group with one teacher and two or three other children. The evidence, and I could give you the example of Chullora Public School around the corner from my office, shows that you take a child like that out of the classroom, put them in a small group with a professional teacher, then what happens is they learn as much in 18 weeks as they normally would learn in a year. Now, they're the sort of things that I mean when I talk about tying funding to the sort of things that are going to help a child who falls behind at primary school to catch up.
We'll get busy on it. I mean, even at private school, parents, if they can afford it, and they can obviously afford it at private schools, getting tuition for their kids so that they can remain in contact with the curriculum. I mean, you know there's an issue. Appreciate you being on. We'll have you on.
That's very true, mate.
You on again. Appreciate it. Thank you, Jane. Anyway, moving on, the latest NAPLAN results have revealed one in three Aussie kids are failing to meet our basic education requirements. Matt, whatever we're doing here, it's not working. 15 years of NAPLAN and this, I mean, what is more important than your child's education?
Well, I was going to say exactly that thing, Carl, that what we are doing is not working. And it's been more than 10 years now since the so-called Gonski reforms, which massively boosted government funding of schools. The Australian government's now spend more than $16,000 per student per year in our schools. That's up from just over $13,000 before the Gonski reforms. And I think the question has to be asked here, why don't we give that $16,000 to the parents and you can decide where your children go to school? Because I reckon you could buy a pretty good education for $16,000 a year, and whatever the education bureaucrats are doing in this country is clearly not working, and maybe it's time to let parents decide where that funding goes.
Well, we have faith in the system, and even those in the private system are spending thousands and thousands of dollars on tuition outside of what is already expensive. The PM says catch-up classes for struggling kids will be prioritised. Heidi, the pressure on state schools is immense, but at almost every level it's a fail.
Yeah, something's gone fundamentally wrong, I think, in our system fairly clearly. I feel like we've spent the last decade debating the merits of the NAPLAN system, not focusing on the kids that aren't doing well in it. I mean, we've gone through patches of time in curriculum where they've focused on the wrong thing. We've had, student-led learning as a process instead of teacher-led learning. I know which version of who the leader of the teacher I would want happening. It's always got to be the teacher leading the learning. Phonics debates. We've had all sorts of debates about sort of core elements of the curriculum, and we're clearly just not getting on with doing them and teaching the kids enough.
This morning, Australia's NAPLAN results have given a reality check to our education system. One in three students have failed to meet minimum standards in reading, writing and maths, while one in 10 are so far behind they're now going to need extra support.
It is not good news. Let's bring in the Australian Curriculum Authority Chief Executive David De Cavillo live in Sydney for us. David, good morning. Thanks for your time. Look, these numbers don't lie. What do you make of the results?
Well, I think we should all be concerned that the NAPLAN results have identified that on average around 10% of students across all the year levels that we test and all the subjects that we test have been identified in a new category, which is called needs additional support. Students in that proficiency level, and there are four of the new proficiency levels, but in that one, which is the bottom group, they are well below expectations for where they should be at the time of the testing.
So why is this happening? Why are so many students falling behind? What areas are the worst? And if we look at this negatively, we can, but is this a positive thing to try and help those students out?
Absolutely. I think there are a number of factors at play when you look at the results. Firstly, there are a range of demographic factors, things that are, if you like, outside the school gate. When you look at the makeup of that bottom group, around one third of them are students from Indigenous backgrounds. Around a quarter are in remote locations. Half of all of them are in very remote locations. Around a quarter of those in that group have parents who did not complete high school. But those demographic factors don't explain everything. We know that there are schools whose students come from very disadvantaged backgrounds who are punching above their weight and supporting their students to make progress. And we need to learn from what those successful schools are doing in terms of things like lesson planning and approaches to teaching, and look for ways to scale up their success. But there's also one interesting phenomenon that is not often commented upon, but it's very clear in the data, And that is that the percentage of students who come from families where the language background is not English, who are in the top exceeding category, that percentage is actually higher than the percentage of students who come from English-speaking families. So there's something there that we need to think about, which is how much we as a culture, if you like, value educational achievement overall, and how that flows through into things such as the extent to which parents support their children in their learning and support the teachers as well.
All right, David, we'll leave it there. Interesting results. We appreciate your time this morning.